giving glory and honor to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To all you God's precious children, there is a Lord, word of the Lord this afternoon, found recorded in the gospel according to Mark in chapter number 5, beginning at verse number 35. Gospel according to Mark, chapter number 5, beginning at verse number 35. We don't found that yet.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Amen. Let us all stand for the reading of God's word. 35 reads, while he was still speaking, there came from the ruler's house some who said, your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further? But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the ruler of the synagogue, do not be afraid, only believe. And he allowed no one to follow him except Peter and James and John, the brother of James. They came to the house of the ruler of the synagogue, and Jesus saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. And when he had entered, he said to them, why are you making a commotion and weeping? The child is not dead, but sleeping. And they laughed at him, but he put them outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with them and went in where the child was laying. Taking her by the hand, he said, Talitha kama, which means little girl, I say to you, arise. And immediately the girl got up and began walking, for she was 12 years old. And they were immediately overcome with amazement. And strictly he charged them that no one should know this and told them to give her something to eat. Amen. Just for a word of today, I just want to tag this passage of scripture from giggles to glory. From giggles to glory. In 1989, I participated in a slam dunk contest held by the Indianapolis Pacers. And Jay, you'll get a good kick out of this. While we was all in the room getting ready for this contest, all the brothers walking around trying to show off how good they thought they were. Everybody trying to be color coordinated, making sure that your Jordans match your shorts and your shorts matched your tank top. Lo and behold, here came in this scraggly looking white guy that looked like Shaggy from Scooby-Doo. He had on some cut-off jeans. His socks didn't have elastic enough to stay up. His tennis shoes, you couldn't even pronounce the name of them because the logo was worn off. He had on a shirt that looked like the Incredible Hulk and ripped out of it and just threw it on the side, so he decided to put it on. And everybody started making fun of him and laughing and joking about the way he came in here in his attire. All he did was laugh along with them, thinking those were some funny and hilarious jokes. But when the competition started, he put on a display that was second to none. We was all sitting there with our mouths wide open, jaws dropped, and this dude was out there doing dunks that we never even saw before. Needless to say, he won the competition, and he took his trophy, and he was able to go and perform at the halftime of the Pacer game, smiling all along the way, letting everybody know that you're laughing right now, but your giggles ain't doing nothing but turning it into my glory. Y'all was laughing at me when I came in, but y'all was crowding me when I left. And somebody's gonna have to understand that there's some people that's laughing at you right now, thinking that you ain't gonna be nothing right now, saying all you're doing ain't gonna accomplish nothing right now. But sooner or later, when God puts his hand on some things, he'll turn your giggles into glory. You're just gonna have to allow God to do what he does best. when you understand this passage of scripture, you will see how when God gets to moving, nothing stops God. And just because God has not arrived in your situation yet doesn't mean that God's not coming. I must only be talking to Sister Tony this Sunday morning. When God gets to moving, I don't care how long it might take him, God is on his way to perform exactly what God said he was going to perform. Delaying God is not doing anything but giving us an opportunity to praise God along the way. That's all the opportunity is for. It's allowing me to thank God for right now. Here we find Jairus meets God and asks the Lord to come to his house because his daughter was gravely ill. He said, Lord, if you only can come to my house, I know that my daughter can be made whole. And I understand if anyone here is a parent, there is nothing more hurtful than to see your child in pain. Yes. Nothing moves us more than to see our little one in need of a physician. Yes, Lord. I can be stricken with pain, but don't stricken my child with it.
Yeah. Yeah.
I can be hungry, but don't let me see my child go hungry. I might not have a job, but don't let me see my kids struggling. Jairus was in a precarious position because he had fame and fortune. He had everything that a man could have, but he couldn't provide a healing for his daughter, which lets us know that it doesn't matter how many degrees you have on the wall, you still need Jesus. It don't matter how much money you have in your bank account, you still need Jesus.
Yes.
It doesn't matter how good you can break down the scripture, you still need Jesus.
Yes.
Jesus ain't impressed by what you have in your wallet.
Yeah.
He ain't impressed by how much education you have.
Yeah. Yeah.
No matter what we do, when we get to the root of the matter, we still need Jesus. He don't care how good of a song you can sing, you still are going to call out for Jesus. He don't care how good you can play the keyboard, you're still going to find a time where I need to have my presence with Jesus. Jerry is asking, can you just come and see about my daughter? I researched the name to understand why he was in this predicament, and the name Jairus means one whom God enlightened. So when he was born and received the name Jairus, it was because of this particular scripture that God knew was going to have to happen. He was enlightened enough to understand that believing in Jesus will get a healing to his daughter. He asked God, just come to my house. And Jesus said, let's roll. Jesus begins to walk with Jairus. And on his way of walking, he's encountered by other folks who were still in need of a physician. God tells us that miracles aren't performed, that we can believe in miracles. Miracles are performed that we might believe in Jesus.
Yes.
Don't believe in the miracle. Believe in the one who performed the miracle.
Yes.
Don't believe in the touching of my garment. Believe in the person who's inside of the garment.
Yes. Yes.
He says, it's me that's doing these things. Don't bank on the miracles. Because if you start looking at the miracles, you'll get sidetracked. And not give God the glory of what has just happened. Mm-hmm. Have you ever been somewhere where something miraculous has happened and somebody gets to shouting and thanking God for what happened instead of thanking God for being God and God all by himself?
Yeah.
We got to learn it ain't in the miracle, It's in the one who performed the miracle. Jesus on his way to Jairus' house. The woman with issue of blood stopped him while he was on the way, delaying Jesus from getting to Jairus' house. As they proceeded to move on, you find that people come running saying, don't even worry about it any longer. The child has passed on. Can you see Jairus' heartbreaking, thinking if this woman had not stopped Jesus, he would have arrived on time enough to save my daughter. Had this crowd not prevented Jesus, my child would have been delayed being in God's presence. How many times have Christian folk wanted their blessings more than God blessing somebody else? How selfish is it that I would rather God come take care of me before he take care of Sister Johnson? Lord, just pass over her problems. Skip over that pew right there. Move past these folks over there, Lord, and just come see about little old me. Jairus believed that God is still able to do even what people say he cannot do. Because faith teaches us how to wait. I think everybody should have said amen right there. Faith teaches us how to wait. You can tell the difference between somebody believing and somebody who is just shucking and jiving. If I believe God can do something, it doesn't matter if God is delayed in his getting here. I believe God is still going to do it. The condition can't get any worse than what it already is, because God can do any problem. He can handle it all. He said, I'm not distracted by what just happened. And Jesus tells him, I understand that the news you heard can be a little bit overwhelming. I understand that the situation just got more complicated in your mind. But don't you fear, only believe. You see, the enemy, the first way he tries to trick us into not believing God doing something is to scare us off our given path. I'm afraid that the thing won't happen. And when I get afraid that it won't happen, I stop acting as if God is going to do it. You can't let fear stop you from doing what God asks you to do. You can't let fear stop you from believing that God can do it. You can't get sidetracked and stop thinking just because God hasn't got there yet that God can't do it. He said, you just got to believe. And he proceeds to go and he just takes the three disciples along with him. Why didn't Jesus take the other guys? Why did he only allow a certain few to get there to witness what he was doing? You will find that I don't care what church you go to, there's some naysayers in the building. There's some people sitting in the building that don't think God can do what God says he can do. You got some people that is trying to hinder you from getting your blessings that God has in store for you, and it can be the person sitting right next to you. He says, I ain't going to take everybody in there because can't everybody handle what's about to happen. The people who I'm taking in there are the people who I'm counting on to share the gospel and let somebody else know God can do anything but fail. He gets there and lets them know that when God enters the place, prestige and honor has to leave. There can only be one king in the house. And titles aren't allowed into my place. If you thinking you are bigger than what you are not in the right place. I'm not calling nobody in here. I'm calling for people who was just merely able to do what I asked
asked him to do.
Yes.
I'm not asking for this great Episcopal to come into place. Mm-hmm. I'm not calling in Pastor Dixon into place.
Well.
I don't need Deacon Dixon in this place.
Yeah.
I just want somebody who's going to believe that I am God and God all by myself.
Oh, yeah.
Titles ain't going to save you when you get to Jesus. Jerry, you know, we don't care how precious you think you are. Right now, I'm coming merely as a daddy. All the other stuff is placed on the back burner. If I can quote the group Journey, they sang a song that says, "Don't stop believing. Just hold on to that fear." That feeling you had when you first asked God if he would do something for you is the same feeling you need when God starts to show up in your situation.
Yeah.
When you was gung-ho saying, "God, I'm going to start this new business. God, I want you to be all in my stuff. God, I want you to do all this and that." That same feeling you had when you started is the same feeling you need when you get to the end. Because the distractions that came in the middle was trying to get you from getting to God's end result. He said, "Don't stop believing. Don't stop believing. Hold on to that feeling." That same feeling you had when you got started is the same feeling you need when you get to the end. That same feeling, Jerry, as you had when you said, "Lord, come to my house," is the same faith you need when I get to the door. Jesus walks in, and you got a crowd of folks in there weeping. And the Bible says they was professional mourners. What kind of person applies for a job to be a professional mourner? A professional mourner. That means that I mourn for a living. This is what's on my resume. What do you do? I've been a mourner for 25 years. I can cry at the drop of a dime. These folks was merely, Jesus says, causing a commotion. Because if you got a child laying there dying or dead, and you got folks over here crying, what you think everybody else is going to do when they walk into the house? You are setting an atmosphere of weeping because of what you are doing. And too many Christians are setting a bad atmosphere in God's church, in God's presence. You're setting a bad atmosphere. You're setting a seed of doubt. You are making other folks think that God is not able to do things. And God says it's time to move these folks out of the situation. Somebody's going to have to go home and start making some inventory and saying, "These folks in here are bad for my situation. You are causing me more trouble than you're causing me some good." It don't matter how great of a friend you think somebody is. If you ain't lifting me up, you don't need to be in my group. If you are here just to pull me down, guess what? I don't need you hanging around. I need somebody that's going to say, "Go ahead and do it. Hang on in there. Keep the faith. You can get it. It's going to happen. Just keep on striking the fight." I don't need nobody saying, "That ain't going to happen. That ain't going to work. He didn't say that. Don't do that. Don't go there. Don't say that. Don't eat that." I want somebody saying, "God is good all the time. And all the time, God is good." If that ain't you, get out of my camp. Jesus said, "Y'all got to get out of here." Because what you guys are doing is hurting the atmosphere. And I'm out to show somebody some things that you guys don't need to be part of. He puts them outside because they was giggling. They was laughing. They were setting seeds of doubt. Jesus says, "We're going to let the gigglers giggle on the outside. Come on, mama and daddy. come on, my three disciples, and let's go in and see where the girl is sleeping at. Can't you imagine the folks saying, why is he saying the child is not dead, but sleeping? It's only encouraging to somebody who's in a situation that looks like it is a dead situation. And it looks like this thing is not going to happen. But this thing is going to happen because it's not dead. Because anytime God puts his hand on something, it can't stay the same way. Jesus says to her, little girl, I say to you, arise. And immediately she began to walk. And immediately she became alive. I like when Jesus shows up in our situations. Because if I can quote a songwriter, it says he may not come when you want him to, but he's always on time. It don't matter when God gets there, as long as I know God's coming, I'm going to keep on hanging in there and wait for my change to come. As long as I know God is on his way, I have faith enough to wait to see what God is going to do. The Bible says, faith that waits upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up on wings as an eagle. They shall walk and not get weary and run and not faint. If you only wait upon the Lord, God says, I've got some things that I can do for you if you have enough faith to believe that I'm able to do it. He tells them to give her something to eat. You're going to have to understand, God wants you to participate in your blessings. God wants you to be active in getting what God wants you to get. If God births something inside of you and God says, this is what I want you to accomplish, you need to feed that thing so that that thing might grow up into something. Don't think that God's going to have you do or him do everything and you ain't going to do nothing. God said you need to participate in your blessings. If you want to start this thing, God says, I need you to put something into it in order for me to help this thing grow into something else. He says, feed it, and then let this thing work. I wonder what we might accomplish if we start putting faith folk out. I wonder what would happen in churches if the churches decide to start letting the faith folk go ahead and leave. I'm convinced that we can do more than with a few real folk than we can do with a whole lot of faith folk. I know if we just start moving out the faith folk, that the good folk will be able to accomplish a whole lot more, because the next says, who was in there trying to quench our fire are no longer there. Those folks who was there sitting on the pew is going to make room for somebody else that God can put in the seat and accomplish a whole lot more. But we got to move out the faith folk. I wanted to pause and have us shut our eyes and give the faith folk a chance to leave, but we'll let them leave when the service is over. Then you don't even have to worry about it. You got some faith folk in your life that God said it's time to get the faith folk out of there. Leave them alone, because they ain't going to do you any good. But I'm going to allow their giggles to turn to your glory. Those folks who was laughing at you are going to be the very ones that God's going to help elevate you to a higher height. The same ones that was giggling when you came in is going to be the same ones whose mouth is going to drop wide open when God exalts you to a higher height. And I only have one more point to make before I crack open this drink and take a sip of this funny colored drink that my mama brought me in here. There was a time I was on a basketball team coached by a guy named Mr. Cox. And the only reason why I was on the team is because Rod was on the team. And Rod was one of the better players on the squad. They needed another player, and Rod told Mr. Cox, I got a buddy who can play. Mr. Cox had never seen me play, but let me be on the team. The team got whooped the first game they played. And Mr. Cox was looking dumbfounded, trying to figure out how in the world do we have a team that has these good of players on it, but yet we can't win the game. Rod told Mr. Cox, you need to put Jerry in. Mr. Cox looked at me like I had the plague. Said, leave this boy on the bench. Second game came and the team got beat by even more than they got beat the first game. Now he began to pull his hair out and was looking like Bozo the Clown. Rod said, you need to put Jerry in. Mr. Cox looked down there again and said, ain't no way I'm putting Jerry in. The third game came, and one of the other players who was a good player on the team got hurt. And he was looking at the bench, wondering, what in the world am I going to do now? Rod said, put Jerry in the game. Mr. Cox looked disgusted and said, come on and get in the game. Needless to say, when Jerry got in the game, things took a turn for the better. The team that was losing began to start winning. Eventually, after we won the championship, Mr. Cox said, boy, I didn't never know that you could play ball like that. Yes. And Rod said, I told you a long time ago to put Jerry in the game. And it's only ironic to me that I find out that too many Christians have heard somebody tell them, just let Jesus get in your situation. But you keep on poking your lip out and say, no, I'm going to handle this all by myself. And you keep on losing game after game. And you go to church Sunday after Sunday, you keep hearing the man of God say, put Jesus in your game. But you keep on saying, I'm not going to put him in my game. I don't want him in my business. I'm going to keep on doing it like I want to do it. But oh, let something bad happen to you. And they have a last resort. You were reminded, somebody said, let Jesus get in the game. So you say, come on, Jesus, and help me out a little bit. And slowly but surely, your situation begins to start changing for the good. That thing that was hindering you all this time starts working in your favor. You start to look back and wonder, how in the world did I get in this bad situation? And it comes to your mind because I didn't let Jesus handle it from the beginning. I took some bumps, and some bruises because I was trying to do it my own way. But when I turned it over to Jesus, things started working in my favor. Is it anybody here that wants Jesus to be on the starting squad? To be my starting center, my starting guard, and my starting boss? I want him in the beginning, I want him in the middle, and I want him in the rear. I can't do this thing by myself, and Lord, I want you to turn these giggles into glory. I want somebody to be able to say, look what God has done in my life. He was once this way, but now he's like that. He once walked that way, but now he walks like that. Thank God for Jesus being on my squad. I feel I'm gonna win the championship. Because Jesus is on the squad. He's going to be the MVP of the league, June. He's going to lead the league in scoring. He's going to lead the league in rebounds. He'll lead the league in assists. Most of all, he's going to lead us to the promised land.
say come on. He's going to take us to where his Father sits, a sinner and a rich.
Undone. Amen. God is good and worthy to be praised. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Today is a good day for us to allow Jesus in our lives. Today's a good day for somebody to say, Lord, get off the bench and come be part of my team. Get off the bench, Lord, and come orchestrate this thing for me. I've been doing it my way for too long, Lord, and I want you, Lord, to be a participant in my life. Somebody ought to give their life to Christ today.
Somebody ought to say to the Lord, I accept you as my Lord and my Savior. Maybe you just want to be a member of a sacred ground worship center. Today is a good day.